We're all familiar with the fundamental theorem of calculus. It's one of the biggest theorems that we study in Calc 1, and it helps us find the area under a curve using antiderivatives, where you take the antiderivative of your integrand and you plug in the upper limit and lower limits of integration and subtract. And that gives you the area under the curve. However, there's another fundamental theorem of calculus, often called the second fundamental theorem of calculus. Now, fair warning, this verbiage changes book to book. I would say the vast majority of the textbooks call what I've been referring to as the fundamental theorem of calculus, the fundamental theorem of calculus, and this one, the second fundamental theorem of calculus. However, other textbooks might call them both the fundamental theorem of calculus, maybe like part one and part two, or maybe even switch the order of these guys. So just fair warning, just read the theorem to see which one your textbook happens to be talking about. But nevertheless, what we're going to refer to as the second fundamental theorem of calculus says this. It says if you've got a function that's continuous on a closed interval, then if you take the derivative of the integral from a to x of f of t dt, then you get blank. Now, instead of just giving it to you, let's just think about this for a minute. What you should notice immediately right here is we have both a derivative and an integral going on. And one thing that we've been stressing is that integrals are basically the opposites of a derivative. You often even call them antiderivatives. And so let's think about this. If you were to integrate this inner term here, the integral from a to x of f of t dt, and get in effect the antiderivative of this function primarily, if you turn right back around and took this guy's derivative, what would you expect to get? Well, hopefully you said you would get the original function back, and that's certainly true. Now I've got one question for you though. Do you think this is going to be f of t or f of x? And that, we haven't really talked about this distinction. We'll get into that in a minute. It's actually going to be f of x. It's going to be f of x. The reason for that is when you integrate little f as a function of t, remember, you're going to plug in an x and plug in an a before differentiating. So your function won't have t's anymore. They'll have x's from that step where you plugged in the limits of integration. So, but in effect, this theorem in a nutshell says that basically derivatives and integrals are inverse operations of one another. If you integrate a function and then turn right back around and differentiate it, you get the same function back, is basically what it's saying here. All right, now a couple of things to note. I think I've actually got three things that I jotted down for us to notice. One thing that's a little strange is in this integral here, this upper limit is not, it's not from a to b, it's from a to x. And there's good reason for that. If this was from a to b, then what would this inside integral right here represent? Well, it would be the area under the curve, right, from a to b. It'd be a numerical answer, it'd be a numerical value. And the derivative of any number would be zero, not f of x. And so by leaving a variable in your upper limit of integration, the thing that you get after you integrate, you plug in a variable, well, it's still a function, it's not a numerical value if you were to plug in an x versus like a 5 or a 6 or something like that. So just remember that. All right, second thing, and we've already kind of talked about this a little bit, but I didn't unpack it fully yet. There's a difference of variables here. Not everything is in terms of x. The x is in the upper limit of integration, but your actual integrand has to be written in terms of t. Now, why is that? Well, I could have a long conversation about why this has to be a t versus an x, but I'll give you the short answer of it. Basically, this guy has to be set. This guy has to be fixed from a to x. And then you're integrating with respect to t, which means once your x is chosen, then the t will range over that interval. But you can't have a floating upper limit of integration that's the same variable that your integrand is written in with respect to. So you would have this weird tension going on there, this weird situation. But if you go from a to x and say, here's a, here's x, even if x is a variable, then once that's chosen, then the t will range back and forth. See, this would actually be like the t-axis would range back and forth from A to X. Now, you could then afterwards change X and, you know, make X a little larger or a little smaller, but nevertheless, you have to use a different letter to range between A and X. All right. Third little note here is that notice when we wrote the second fundamental theorem of calculus here, we said that the derivative of this integral from a to x of f of t dt is f of x, but there's no mention of a. A doesn't seem to play any role in anything, and in fact it doesn't really. The lower limit of integration, is irrelevant. It could be 5 to x or 7 to x or 10 to x or negative 2 to the 2 to x, and your answer would always just be f of x. Now, why? Why is the a irrelevant? Well, if we run through the math, we'll see why this happens. Let's do the integral on the inside first. The antiderivative of little f of t would be capital F of t, and we put a bracket from an a to an x, and then we plug in an x and we plug in an a. So you'd have capital F of x minus capital F of a. Fundamental theorem of calculus, the first one. All right, and then this is the guy we're going to take the derivative of. Now, the derivative of capital F of x, being that it has a variable, would be this guy. It'd be little f of x. But then you'd have minus, and then what's the derivative of capital F of a? Well, I don't know what capital F is, but I know that when you plug in any constant, it'll be a constant, right? You plug a numerical value into a function, you get a numerical value. And so what would the derivative of this be, regardless of the a, would be zero, right? And so we never actually even write that term, really. And so we see this a turns out to be irrelevant as far as the derivative of the integral. All right, now let's just run through an example here. Now, these examples are funny. I have students all the time that'll, you know, take tests on this. And this, if you think about it correctly, is actually one of the easiest topics covered in this integral section. But this is usually one of the most missed questions on most of my chapter tests, because students overcomplicate it. So here's an example. What's the derivative of the integral from 5 to x of the square root of t squared plus 1 dt? Well, a lot of students think this. They think, okay, all right, Devin, I know what I need to do. I need to do this integral here, right? Find this antiderivative, plug in x, plug in 5, and subtract. And then I need to take a derivative. That's seemingly what it says. But if you know the second fundamental theorem of calculus, it's done. It's extremely simple. We don't actually have to take the antiderivative. Why? Because I know in as soon as I have it in my hand, I'm going to turn right back around and take its derivative. So why do either one? At the end of the day, this will come back to the same function. Now, will it be the square root of t squared plus 1? Not exactly. It'll actually be the square root of x squared plus 1 from plugging in the x and plugging in the 5 and subtracting, but it is just the same function. And so thank goodness, because otherwise this really would be a hard problem. Try integrating that guy. U substitution doesn't work. There's no basic integration rules that work. That guy would be a nightmare to try to integrate, but thankfully I don't have to, because if I were going to, I would turn right back around and take that answer's derivative. So we can just jump straight to the answer very, very quickly. So this is primarily how you'll be asked questions about the second fundamental theorem of calculus. So just make sure to recognize it and try not to overcomplicate the problem.